Laura Di Bianco is an assistant professor of Italian studies at Johns Hopkins University, whose research and teaching interests lie at the intersection of Italian studies, film studies, women's and gender studies, and environmental humanities. Her first book project, Wandering Women, Urban Ecologies of Italian Feminist Filmmaking, is forthcoming from Indiana University Press and investigates the work of contemporary Italian women directors from feminist and eco-critical perspectives. At Johns Hopkins, Laura teaches classes on Italian cinema, modern and contemporary Italian literature, and eco-criticism. And she is the co-editor of the academic journal MLN, Modern Language Notes. Please welcome Laura Di Bianco.
First of all, the title of the presentation has changed is Literature for the Others. Sorry, I didn't have time to tell you. So today I'm sharing a developing essay that originates from a course I taught this spring semester. Climate change narratives, human and non-human transformative storytelling. This course is part of a research project at its early stages, so I'd be very grateful for any form of feedback. Over the last decades, climate change and environmental degradation have been steering the imaginary of filmmakers, novelists, and artists who are finding ways to framing and plotting, performing, and even singing about these unimaginable phenomenon and adopting new modes of storytelling to grapple with what Amitav Ghosh called the unthinkable. As often happens when artists attempt to tackle a controversial topic, they resort to experimentation and the hybridity of language, genre, and media. The literature on the topic of climate change is overwhelmingly vast, and contemporary works that address or eloquently conceal some aspects of climate change or give voice to endangered communities or bring into view landscapes of the Anthropocene are pervasive. And it is important to recognize prophetic works from the past that were either explicit in warnings of environmental or ecological disasters or can be productively reread from an eco-critical perspective. The works I selected for my course range from documentary films like The Anthropocene, The Human Epoch, How Humans Have Impacted the Planet, a Canadian documentary film that abounds with alienating views from above, the French post-apocalyptic novel Just After the Wave by Sandrine Collette, and the darkly hilarious fragmentary American novel by Jenny O'Feel, Weather, and the Lithuanian opera The Sun and the Sea, awarded the Golden Lion at the 2019 Venice Biennale, in which singers lie on the beach, apparently carefree, but they sing songs about acidy waves and exhaustion and extinction. As I started assembling a body of texts, I was confronted with the problem of limited possibility of representing Italy in a world in which a variety of climate change narratives are available in translation or with English subtitles. Few are from Italy. This is puzzling since a vast number of Italian ecofilms address environmental degradation, which is certainly related, but in fact climate change as a broader issue has been rarely addressed. Happily, if perversely so, in literature, climate change in conjunction with COVID-19 pandemic has percolated into Italy's literary imagination in absorbing and poetic ways. This is the case of Filelfo's L'Assemblea degli Animali, an important book that unfortunately I could not teach because, again, it's not available in translation. But so allow me to talk about it today. L'Assemblea is a fable in a sub-tradition, but also a clarified COVID narrative, an ecological pamphlet in a sort of handbook of ecological education. This is, for me, the most fascinating aspect, or an ecological conversion, to quote Pope Francisco. And like any fable, there is some mystery to it as well. The manuscript appearance seemingly came out of nowhere, a sort of postmodern deus ex machina, minus a final divine resolution, mysteriously delivered by email to Robinson, the cultural magazine of the newspaper La Repubblica, in July 2020, amid the global pandemics of COVID-19. In November of the same year, it was published as an illustrator book by the prominent publisher Einaudi, and I'm showing drawings by Riccardo Mannelli in my PowerPoint presentation. The book is authored by an unknown writer named Filelfo, who, like Elena Ferrante, has never appeared in public and whose identity and gender remains uncertain. While the pen name suggests he's a man, I believe Filelfo is the scholar Silvia Ronchey. I have no proofs whatsoever, but it's just my feeling. A professor of Byzantine civilization at Roma III. But let's talk about the book for now and just acknowledge that the concealment of the identity sparks our curiosity in addition to giving the book a certain authority. Interestingly, the biographical note provided in the book jacket presents Filelfo as an humble, marginal literary figure, a copy editor, translator, and an encyclopedia's writer, who lives and teaches in the Roman countryside. The name itself, Filelfo, recalls the Renaissance humanist Francesco Filelfo, but in a written interview conducted by journalist Raffaella De Santis for La Repubblica, the author explains that their pen name is a collective one derived from participation in the Filelfi, an ancient trade guild's trades, like languages, traditions, and popular wisdoms go extinct like animals, said Filelfo, and then continued, I don't use my real name because Filelfo does not speak for themselves, but for the others, for the animals, and with the voices of others. That is, using the words of those who in the history of literature precede them. And the book is what Roland Barthes would call a tissue of quotations, a sophisticated array of fragments from texts of all times ingeniously patched together in a limpid prose. The book opens with Calvino, L'ultimo viene il corvo. Then the most erudite readers will find references to Lucrezius de Rerum Natura, Aristophanes the Frogs, mixed with the verses from the Odyssey and Collodi's Pinocchio, along with Camus the Plague. Allusion to Shakespeare are here and there, citation of Carroll's Alice and Alice's Adventures in Wonderland and Moby Dick. Page after page, we detect traces of Virginia Woolf, Jack London, Nietzsche, Baudelaire, Thoreau, Plato, T.S. Eliot, Pascoli, Borges, and most importantly, Ovid, Metamorphosis. Readers of environmental literature will hear echoes of fundamental texts like Rachel Carson's The Silent Spring. And social media users might recall Instagram videos that went viral. All these words are spoken by the animals who elaborate on human hubris and wisely plan how to force humans to modify their modes of existence to secure the survival of all living species. And in the end, a rich bibliography reveals all the sources, perhaps taking scholars' fun away, but providing readers guidance for an ecological education or conversion. The book is dedicated to Ash, the first koala born from the ashes of millions of animals who perished in the 2019-2020 Australian bushfires season. It established thus human responsibilities for that animal's holocaust and configures the pandemic as a punishment for humans' irresponsibility toward the planet. Alarmed by the destruction brought by the that dark summer, non-human animals gather in assembly where a koala, survivors of the wildfires, gives a sorrowful account of the events and describes a horrifying scenario of death, a destroyed habitat, millions of animals carbonized or asphyxiated or killed by thirst and dehydration. Determined to stop humankind from destroying the planet, animals decide to send a severe warning upon the suggestion of the rats, historically responsible for the contagion of the plague, a bat will transmit a virus. In a remote countryside village, a boy captures a pangolin who has been bitten by a bat. Brought to a wet market to be sold, the pangolin clung on a pig. The contagion has started. The storyline is an obvious reference to the spillover, the supposed origin of COVID-19 transmission to humans, that Filelfo reminds us in the above-mentioned interviews is related to biodiversity loss caused by deforestation and industrially intensive agriculture. What follows is a tender, at times playful description of the lockdown. From the animal's point of view, the confinement in private spaces imposed by law in Italy, among other countries, the policed walking and controlled proximity among humans, and the exasperated though liberating walking of dogs that prompted, in some cases, a canine rental industry. The silence broken by the singing from the windows. Umani chiusi nelle loro gabbie stavano cantando proprio come uccelli, o meglio, come uccelli in gabbia, wrote Filelfo. And the odd wonders of the lockdown, the nature epiphany, animals invading urban spaces emptied of cars, bodies of water getting bluer and quieter, air cleaner and breathable. Humans contemplated nature while fearing extinction. Beyond animals' expectation, though, the contagion goes too far. 6.22 million of dead, according to data from Johns Hopkins University. Ne morirono a migliaia is the title of a mournful chapter told by the point of view of Momo, a dog who survives the death of his owner, of his companion species, a doctor. Out of grief, Momo lets himself die and transform into an animandro, a term that, alas, is not as inclusive gender-wise as it should be. But let's translate it as human and non-human hybrid. And so many others, an elderly cyclist turns off horse, a woman victim of domestic abuse becomes mermaid. In the poetic finale, the animandri, living hybrids of all sorts, ascend to the sky over realms created by the stars to gather in a new assembly. Humans regain the animality that they have lost, in other words, the sense of interconnectedness with the known human world. The metamorphosis in animandri proposed by Filelfo, it is not a punishment as in Ovid's myths, but a reawakening or the recovery of a kinship. As posthumanist philosopher Leonardo Caffo explains in his 2012 Adesso l'animalità, La metamorfosi risiede non tanto nel voler salvare l'animale perché ci assomiglia o perché la nostra sorte è comune, ma nel diventare noi stessi animali, nel comprendere che solo decostruendo i falsi bisogni del cittadino possiamo finalmente impedire alla violenza di perpetuarsi e alle varie crisi di mostrarsi come negative quando sono invece la possibilità di quel cambiamento necessario. And this is essentially the important lesson taught by the animals philosopher from l'Assemblea. There's one problematic aspect, maybe more, but there's one I identified, Filelfo's COVID fable. Animals wage a war against humankind. The idea that an offended nature might rebel against humans can potentially contribute to further alienating humans from the non-human world. Working against the idea of kinship, co-presence and connectedness, or shared vulnerability, to quote Serenella Iovino, at the core of an ecological thought. Nevertheless, by placing non-human animals at the center of the narrative, and in film, I would say, visually adopting the point of view, l'Assemblea degli Animali gestures toward a bioegalitarian view of the world, and while denying human moral preeminence, invites readers to becoming animals. A non-anthropocentric narrative, l'Assemblea presents non-human animals as storytellers and agents of change. And in so doing, that is, by granting non-humans agency, it initiates an imaginative shift necessary to reverse the destructive human-centered narrative we have seen so far. Thank you.
Do you know if there are any plans to have this translated or available?
I hope so. I truly hope so. I am sure it's going to happen. It got a lot of attention, and I think it deserves it. So it is my hope that it will be available so that we can expand these bodies of eco stories that we can teach and write about.
I have two questions. One is what the audience, is it thought for children or for adolescents? Or, and the other one, how do you know who the author is?
Okay.
She's an historian of Byzantine history, you said?
No, okay, the first, I want to answer your first question was about the audience. Well, it is marketed as a fable that can speak to children and to adults. I don't believe as can be fully understood by children because the very fascinating aspect of this work is precisely that this patching of quotations and the intertextual dialogue that entertains with works from the past and the present. Of course, it can be received in different ways. And there's a very, what I love about this text is the very playful tone and sometimes the animalization of Italian sayings and prayers. That certainly can speak to children too. The hypothesis is just about me listening to a podcast during the pandemic by Silvia Ronquet. It's a long series, Umili Eroi, I want to say, but I have it in my notes, I'll be happy to share, but I'm not sure 100%, and the way she talked about the work right after the publication made me feel that she might be the author. But as I said, I don't have proof. But I think there's been hypotheses and by others, the journalists, that it could have been Silvia Ronquet.
Animandro, you pointed out it's not the best option.
Yeah.
But I'm wondering why, I mean, obviously who wrote the book has an obvious understanding and knowledge of these issues. So I wonder if you think that the choice of the name was at some specific meaning, or she could have chosen some other term that would be more encompassing. So I'm wondering.
Right.
So why? I mean, maybe there is some meaning behind it, or if you thought about that, or.
No, I was just saying, I have to admit that, not admit because I didn't write the book, but and I'm happy to criticize it, that I was quite disappointed by this choice of this androcentric term. And I also want to go deeper into the gender politics of the book. There's one part, one chapter devoted to the Sirena, the mermaid, that I fear it falls into that essentialization of women as closer to nature, what essentially destroyed the project of ecofeminism back in the 70s and made it a, as has been said, a tainted word. So I don't have an answer about the why they or he, I don't know, chose this term, but I agree, as I pointed out, that it's not the most inclusive gender-wise. And there are other aspects of the book that signaled some troubles in that area. But still, there's a lot to learn.
Thank you so much for being here. So this talk has allowed me to reread Fabrizia Ramondino after a while, 1936-2008, a very interesting writer who has struggled to establish herself in the Italian scene. I worked on her in the past, still I'm always surprised by the variety of themes she deals with in her novels, specifically those where conspicuous reference to animals, natures, landscapes emerge, all of which I believe deserve more critical attention. Today I will focus on Ramondino's late production, L'Isola Riflessa, 1998, and Guerra d'Infanzia di Spagna, 2001, which was recently republished by Fazzi in 2022. So I hope that this new edition can shed light on Ramondino and on the novel. So my thesis is that these novels provide different examples of a material world, and of how human beings relate to the environment, topics that, as we know, are central to the contemporary environmental debates. Moreover, I suggest analyzing Ramondino's works as crucial examples of environmental writings, in which it's possible to identify two goals that, according to Serenella Iovino, distinguish this genre. And I have here, and I'm going to quote, an epistemological objective, which aims to create in the reader a problematic idea of the relationship between humanity and nature, and a political objective, which consists of the use of rhetorical techniques or imaginaries, I will say, to develop new attitudes, new behaviors with respect to the environment and non-human forms of life, end of quote. An ecological reading of these novels will allow a different interpretation, I believe, of Ramondino's works, improve her profound ecological thought, which scholars have largely overlooked. In Guerra d'Infanzia di Spagna, the protagonist Titita, Ramondino's alter ego, recounts her childhood in the island of Mallorca. It's an island that acquires fantastic traits and where she lives in an almost symbiotic relationship with nature, epitomized by the plants and flowers of the garden house. First, we can observe that Titita cannot think of her existence in the world unless she relates it to the vegetal species of her garden. For instance, after observing the edible species of her garden, she assumes she belongs to a comestible species as well. And I quote, ma queste raffigurazioni commestibili di foglie mi sgomentavano. Se infatti nel giardino tutte le cose erano commestibili e ogni cosa, come io sapevo, era per qualsiasi altra cosa commestibile, allora anche io lo ero. E più masticavo erbe e bacche, più mi convincevo che se ero mangiatrice potevo a mia volta essere mangiata. End of quote. Moreover, it's significant that Titita, during her childhood, claims that she was growing as the flowers and the plants of her garden, and she even imagines that she was born in a similar way that plants are. Indeed, she remembers what her mom once told her about the possibility of grafting plants and branches, fare innesti, as a way of giving life to new plants, and she believes that she's the result herself of a similar process. And I have another quotation. Mammita mi aveva mostrato come piantando talee di gerani e fiori di fucsie, queste invece di seccare crescevano e si sviluppavano diventando nuove piante, sicché immaginavo che la mamma avesse piantato un pezzo di se stessa per farmi crescere in un bel giardino di Napoli. E però, quando la guardavo, non notavo in lei parti mancanti. End of quote. We should consider these examples of, as evidence of Titita's ecological identity, which indicates the way subjects are able to think and interpret themselves in relation to the non-human other, or as Mitchell Tomasho argues, and I quote, ecological identity refers to all the different ways people construe themselves in relationship to the earth as manifested in personality, values, actions, and sense of the self, nature becomes an object of identification, end of quote. Another interesting theme of the novel is how Titita perceives her body, often putting it in relation to other entities or subjects. For example, she feels that her body is never the same, it doesn't have a fixed form, as if it were crisscrossed by forces that Titita calls new energies, and I'm not going to read these, but the body is crisscrossed by force which destabilizes it. Or another interesting quotation is about the perception of her body, is the following. Quando ero vestita, perfino quando ero vestita solo d'acqua o di talco, il mio corpo mi sembrava continuasse in quello degli altri. In quello di Dida, the nanny, the balia, di mammita, nelle piante perfino. Diventava piccolo o grande, si allargava, si allungava, si gonfiava, si sgonfiava. Spariva del tutto le rare occasioni in cui potevo dormire vicino a mammita. End of quote. Titita's perceptions of bodies, of her body, seem to dialogue perfectly with Deleuze and Guattari's definition of reality, a concept that is at the core of the Deleuzean ontology. In A Thousand Plateaux, 1987, Deleuze and Guattari discuss how reality is no longer based on the relationship between form and matter, as claimed by Romantic philosophy, but on the direct relation material forces. In The Logic of Sensation, 1981, a book dedicated to Francis Bacon's paintings, Deleuze observes what happened when these forces, process of becomings, affect the human body. He observes that the entire body, and I quote, tends to escape from itself, and the human figure tends to return to the material structure, end of quote. Deleuze's conception of matter and reality, where bodies interact with what surrounds them, exchange energies, and mingle together, as in Bacon's famous triptych, and here I have another detail, came to my mind when I read Ramondino's novels, specifically Titita's description of her interaction with the plants. The garden becomes this material place where she can mingle with different entities or even turn into something else. And here is an interesting passage where she describes herself in comparison with her brother, Carlito. And she says, and I quote, Carlito era tutto diverso da me. In giardino spariva. Ma questo non significa che si confondesse con le cose o si mescolasse. This ability of mingling with things, it's a prerogative only of Titita. A me quando baciavo mammita o Dida, accadeva di non esserci più, perché mi ero trasformata in un'altra cosa. And this is an example of how she transforms, or she mingles with things, no? In the garden, and I quote, quando tornavo dal giardino, mi rimproveravano per via delle macchie sugli abiti. Ma non sono macchie, rispondevo, ed ero segretamente felice di averla addosso. Poco prima ero stata acqua, frutta, erba, terra. E acqua, frutta, terra, erba, una volta separatemi da loro, erano diventate macchie. End of quote. In another novel, L'Isola Riflessa, nature's representation differs significantly from Guerra, because I would say the novel setting is far from the idyllic place of Mallorca, where Titita spends her childhood. The anonymous female narrator and protagonist of L'Isola observes that nature exists separated from humanity on Ventotene, the island which belongs to the Pontine Archipelago. And I have this quotation that, according to me, it's really interesting, of this separate distance from humanity, from nature. Le canne, and I quote, all'alba, quando l'ebbrezza mattutina è leggera, hanno movimenti lenti, nobili e solenni, quasi si impediscono di frusciare. Non si somigliano alla canna pensante di Pascal. Sembra che invece siano esse a piegare la brezza, a inclinarla con autorevole dolcezza verso il mare, da dove è venuta a turbare il loro sereno dominio. Non vogliono somigliare all'uomo. End of quote. And the emphasis is mine. The reference to Pascal's thoughts is clear. Pascal claims that human beings are the most delicate creatures in nature and the whole universe, but they differ from the other reeds because of their rationality. Therefore, the universe could easily hurt human beings and dominate them. But even when this happens, humanity will still be nobler, superior than the universe, because individuals are aware of their limitations. Individuals are aware that they can die from the confrontation with nature. I think that Ramondino crucially subverts Pascal's image, emphasizing the distance, the separation between nature and humanity, and pointing out that nature, and reeds in this case, is an entity irreducible to humanity. On the island, nature appears an autonomous entity, at least in the present, as the following quotation proves, a quotation which, according to Domenico Scarpa, is a thematic and stylistic microcosm of the whole book. And I'm not going to read all, but just emphasizing what I put in bold. On the island, different plants grow despite them favorable meteorological conditions. This vegetation has undergone a self-selection process and has grown despite, we could claim, the presence or absence of humanity. The only human traces remains in the narrator's semantic choices and images she deploys to describe the peculiarity of the plants and flowers, or what we could claim an herbarium. For instance, the helichrysum, I think, whose flowers are already dried when they spring, is compared to some newly born babies with wrinkled faces like older people. The cistus, whose flowers and silky, virgin, sensual petals recall Simone Weil's young and florid face, not yet exhausted by the world events that compromised her health. In Ramondino's use of human traits or images to describe some plants represent a significant inversion of the poetic repertoire, where the human physical characteristics are those traditionally associated with or metaphorical described through floral or arboreal imaginaries. Furthermore, this inversion emphasizes how nature no longer represents exclusively the second element of a comparison. I don't know. La pelle vellutata come il pesco, la bocca sensuale come la rosa, no? Rather, it becomes the subject of the comparison. We can interpret this as another crucial example of how Ramondino challenges anthropocentrism and humanity's alleged superiority with respect to nature. Moreover, the book reminds readers of different occasions in which human beings have referred to nature to find similarities, images, or models to apply to their existence. Human beings, for example, have observed the acanthus. Its elegant leaves have inspired them to create the Corinthian order, as well as represent human feelings, behaviors, or desires. But another significant aspect of L'Isola Riflessa is that plants contain their own pedagogical qualities. The narrator provides us with an example, for example, of the flower Sole Belle di Notte, which taught her mildness and how to abandon judgment. She also mentions an experiment conducted by the King of Naples, Ferdinand IV of Bourbon, and his advisor, Mr. Pallante, in 1768. Inspired by Rousseau's theories, this experiment consisted of bringing into the island groups of criminals, thieves, procurers, prostitutes, and establishing a community. In this way, they would have received some opportunities to redeem themselves through the contact with nature and through farming, which would have reintegrated them into the civic consortium. Consorzio civile. The conditional mood is required because the narrator soon clarifies that the experiment failed. However, despite its negative results, the narrator of L'Isola tends to agree with Rousseau in considering the proximity to nature. The state of nature for Rousseau coincides with a primitive state preceding socialization. The proximity to nature is the ideal condition that can inspire a change for humanity. And I quote, ma è proprio lo stato selvaggio, quello più favorevole, secondo Jean-Jacques, a che le piante umane, asociali, infruttuose, malvagie, possono diventare sociali, fruttifere, buone, se opportunamente guidate. End of quote. It's striking the narrator chose of the image of the human plants, which to my knowledge is not used by Rousseau, who is directly quoted also in other passages. She emphasized in this way the centrality and necessity of the proximity to nature for humanity's survival, and more interestingly, she puts both nature and humanity on the same level, human plants. The banking and ideas of human beings' superiority. This does not mean that the narrator, alias Ramondino, envisions, also for L'Isola Riflessa, envisions the possibility of a return to an ideal past, epitomized by Rousseau's state of nature. On the contrary, Ramondino uses Rousseau's image as a powerful metaphor to discuss, or even criticize, the present corruption of the world, produced by civilization, similarly to Leopardi's approach in the Zibaldone o in Discorso della Poesia Romantica. In Ramondino, as Adalgiso Giorgio claims, it is visible the progress brought by globalization with the negative effects of a new type of a social and economic order. Now the island appears mainly as a summer tourist attraction where everything revolves around economic interest. The uncontaminated nature, which grew in every angle of the island in the past, is now entrapped in heavy cement vases, a sign of humanity's conquest of nature. But we were told, on the contrary, that humans used to live close to nature. The trees of prickly pears and mulberries, for example, were respected and considered a big attraction for kids and adults alike. Children used to pick some fruits naked because of the stains that mulberry could leave on their clothes. So they played and imagined that the stains on their bodies were their tattoos or wounds that enemies have inflicted. Similarly, the prickly pear fruits were picked and sold in the island, but today no one wants to touch both trees. And Ramondino suggests, and I quote, forse perché queste innocenti macchie color sangue, the mulberries, e le spine che sembrano fare tanto paura ai bambini e alle loro mamme, li riconducono a un mondo arcaico e reale dal quale fuggono, ogni giorno senza saperlo, preferendo le moderne immagini di sangue e di guerra fornite dalla TV. End of quote. This last quotation reiterates the distance or the separation between nature and humanity that characterized the contemporary life on the island and proves the missing link between the subject and nature, which according to Giorgio is one of the aims of the book. In recognizing this link and working to build a community based on cooperation e condivisione, continues Giorgio, individuals will be able to overcome the conflicts, intolerance, and suffering that continue to plague humanity. To conclude, both novels, Guerra d'Infanzia di Spagna e L'Isola Riflessa, emblematically show Ramondino's ecological thought and their interest in investigating the relationship between nature and humanity. The fact that nature, rather than humanity, became the measure for all things, the image of the human plants, the reeds, or Titita's perception of the bodies, are all significant examples of how Ramondino modifies cultural models in a more inclusive way. An imaginary not only proved that she problematized the relationship between humanity and nature, but also aimed to develop new behaviors with respect to the environment, which were the two prerogatives that I mentioned at the beginning that for Jovino characterize environmental writings. Last but not least, in both novels, the idea emerged that humanity's survival as a species, and I quote from Jovino, can only happen if humanity is accompanied by non-human life forms, end of quote. Therefore, we can only hope and need to hope that human beings realize what the reeds can still teach them, what the reeds can still teach us. Thank you.
I'm just wondering if you can talk a little bit about the gender implication of your analysis. Because if I understood correctly, that most of these characters who see themselves in continuity with the material world are mostly like women, right?
So, mm-hmm. Yeah, of course, I think that there is, if we can read as in a lens of ecofeminism, you know, and the theories that claim that women biological are more open and close and connected to the earth. So I think that this goes in the direction that you were pointing out.
Also, I thought it was not coincidental that the you know, she entered in polemic with like male, you know, Pascal and Rousseau.
Yeah, and in the second in L'Isola, and I was thinking, it's full of quotations, there is this interesting play of intertextuality. But yes, Rousseau, Leopardi are mentioned, Pascal, and the thinking reed that I was not aware of. Until I read this.
Rosella, thank you for this beautiful presentation. It's really a very sophisticated reading of Ramondino. I just wanted to follow up on what you just mentioned, that there might be at the core of these novels an ecofeminist stance, and I just wanted you to elaborate a little bit about it, and also if you could go back to the idea of the distance from nature and how you reconcile that with the attempt of challenging the known anthropocentric narrative.
So So for the first question, this is my interpretation. Of course, all the protagonists are women, and there is, I think it's Sullivan that mentions that women are more connected to the world and to nature, and that they always have considered in this dichotomy, no, nature versus culture with men, no, or bodies versus rationality, instinct versus mind, etc. So I think at least this is my interpretation, that we are going in that sense. But I have to say that the majority of Ramondino's texts are autobiographical. We can talk about autofictions and how the fictionalized narrator comes up. So it's a plus that Ramondino is describing her experience, especially l'Isola Riflessa. From the second questions that you mentioned, I see the distance. I mean, I see also, it is clear to me, not only in these novels, but also in other works by Ramondino, that she envisions the only possibility for human survival in the reconnection with nature. And this reconnection with nature can assumes different forms. While the distance that you were mentioning appears in L'Isola Riflessa because the nature has been completely transformed by the gentrification, we could say, the transformation of the city to build new houses for tourists, etc. So this is the point, and this is why she emphasized that we can only survive if we come back to what humans or humanity have already. And it's not something new. And this makes me think of Leopardi. Many times, right? He will say that things changed when we came to contact with l'altro fascia del vero, non lo so, no? The quando tutte le illusioni cadono, exactly. In this moment, when something, when a fracture happens, this is when this distance between nature and humanity appears.
Just many thanks for your presentation. I just want to add something to the last question, maybe about this idea of opposition between a savage state of mind and developed and rational state of mind as a disruption in some sense. It's quite curious that in an almost contemporary author, no, there is such a binary approach to nature and culture, and I think that finally you mentioned Deleuze, but the idea of rhythm is much more circular and ramificated, not so binary, no? Mm-hmm. So just as a solicitation.
Yeah, it is true, and also the idea of the roots and rootedness.
I wondered if you have read how familiar you are with Dacia Maraini's works, mm-hmm. because this isn't the first presentation that made me think of Don in Guerra, which I've written about, and I don't know how aware Dacia was, you know, when she was writing it, but it was there's definitely, I was kind of surprised to see these novels were they're not so recent, I mean, but they seem. No. They seem like they could have been written even longer ago, as people mm-hmm. have pointed out, with the kind of the binary nature of, you know, the way she's talking about things doesn't seem super conscious. But anyway, all I wanted to say was you might want to reread Don in Guerra, because it was interesting that these two novels, one has Guerra in the title and one has Isola, and it takes place on an Isola. There's just so many similarities. So just you might want to check that out.
Thank you.
Rose Facchini is a lecturer in Italian at Boston University and is the assistant editor and Italian translation editor for the International Poetry Review. Her main research focuses on how Italian cities imagine the rapidly changing landscape through science fiction and how this correlates in the real world with policymaking and sociocultural adjustments. FACCHINI is a Bread Loaf alumna, and her translations of contemporary Italian poetry appear in the International Poetry Review. She has published her nonfiction work in military medicine and has received several fellowships and grants, including the Catherine Davis Fellowship for Peace and the Catherine Bakeless Nason Endowment. She holds an MA in Italian Literary Studies from the Italian Language School at Middlebury College and an MA in International Relations from Salve Regina University. Please welcome Rose FACCHINI.
In Caterina Franciosi's eco-dystopian novella Terra Nova, man-made environmental disasters have caused Earth to become an uninhabitable, toxic wasteland, forcing the world's population to abandon it and water the stars in search of a new home. These pioneers founded the capital city of New Beacon on the distant planet of Gamma 7, and determined not to repeat their mistakes, established a utopian society in which nature remains a controlled and untouchable commodity. Generations passed, and the ruling triumvirate now maintains strict control of the environment and citizens alike through widespread propaganda, invasive surveillance, and military force. The rebels who question such authority seek refuge in the borderlands or find themselves surreptitiously exiled on the Terran homeland. In this fictional narrative, ersatz substitutes, bright colors, and nanotechnology-powered augmented realities supersede Gamma 7's flora and fauna. The ruling government seeks to control, conquer, or civilize nature, and the resulting environmental mandates prohibit humans from fully taking part in it. After the mysterious death of his wife, the novella's protagonist, Emil, questions this carefully crafted experience on New Beacon and is condemned to live out his days, however few, as an exile on Earth. He finds that despite the radiation, primordial landscape, and barbaric remnants of human civilization, Emil finally feels as though he truly lives when he takes his place on this abandoned, noxious planet. To him, it offers a more real experience than the fantasied safety of a technologically advanced society that a select few elite rule with fear and the illogical persistence of tradition. Science fiction immerses readers in an environmental experience that is unlike their own, and in the case of climate fiction and eco-dystopias, it creates a space in which to engage with climatic issues and reflect upon a more equitable approach to imbalanced environmental policies. My paper takes a close reading approach to the textual visibility of color in Franciosi's work, in which the author weaves together light, darkness, and color to highlight her meditation on the human relationship with the environment. Color, whether superimposed, inherent, or lacking entirely, transforms people, landscapes, and food into a surreal experience and explores the interaction between human and non-human. Franciosi's reflection on the inextricable link between nature and humankind manifests in the freedom that Emil finds on our damaged planet. This Italian writer uses the environment as a platform and color as an amplifier to contemplate our role in the natural cycle and how we live with the consequences of our actions. Franciosi's distinction between superimposed artificial colors and inherent natural colors run along the fault lines of the novella's two-part structure. The reader learns in the first half of the novella that in terraforming Gamma 7, humans have implemented an abundance of synthetic polychromatic lighting to oppose the planet's prevalent darkness and rather monochromatic palette. These colors, more often hyper-realistic than not, do not constitute an inherent property of objects, individuals, or nature, but are rather a hued overlay meant to augment or to create an abstract illusion. The green and brown lights of New Beacon's park intensify the colors of the grass and trees alike, while a host of different but clearly distinguished soft-colored lights at the Hilton pub draw abstract figures on the walls of the room. Many of the city's vividly colored lights fluctuate, such as the pulsating lights and colored festoons of Emil's graphics tables. Some mutate from one color to the next, as with the pub's lights that superficially change Emil's arm from canary yellow to scarlet red until they reach a delicate violet hue, or the mesmerizing floating kaleidoscope of fireworks, where red turns to purple and then to blue and then again to white, in a flourishing of phantasmagoric hues. The terms phantasmagoric and kaleidoscope both reinforce this illusory sense of the planet's artificial colors, a transitory property with no inherent substance, and a continuously shifting pattern in a constant state of flux. This meticulously curated chromatic veneer helps create a psychological effect on the colony's population, rendering a carefully created illusion much like the utopia it claims to be. The reader encounters the power that color holds over Emil by way of his occasional ruminations on New Beacon's abstract and artificial chromatic qualities. To him, the pub lights that morph the color of his arm into a rainbow touch points on the chromatic scale that bewitches the imagination. Colors and the infinite chromatic games deriving from them mesmerize and enchant him, and his relationship with color resembles one of master and slave. The fluctuation from one color to the next, however, reflects Emil's wavering trust in the society and foreshadows his eventual act of rebellion. This fascination undoubtedly springs in part from the fact that Gamma 7 is a dark world, so the colors enhance experiences and distract the population from the extended periods of dusk and night. In other words, the true nature of the planet. Humankind disrupts this through artificial overlaid color in an attempt to achieve Terran aesthetics and regain obsolete circadian rhythms. The artificiality of light through color resembles the artificiality of life on New Beacon that takes a number of forms. The fake grass that covers the floor of the continental show where Emil works, the pleasant scent of flowers thanks to strategically hidden diffusers, the bland processed food, the faux wood furniture, implanted nanobots that display credits and menus advertising tasteless slops. Artificial light and color help New Beacon become a faro, in an otherwise dark and empty system, yet it is an illusion to help citizens temporarily forget their social and political constraints, much like the fireworks help them forget the cold felt in their legs and feet while waiting for the festivities of the annual celebration to begin. A life lived but not felt. On Earth, to which New Beacon exiles its political dissidents, color instead constitutes an inherent aspect of objects, people, and nature. The Odawari, one of the indigenous earth tribes that assist the New Beacon exiles, display signs of what appears to be radiation poisoning and suffer from large brown, red or red-brown spots on the skin around their eyes. These red spots are not synthetically superimposed on their skin, but rather born of it and manifested as disease. The mosquito bites that the exiles endure upon their arrival manifest in a similar manner. The wolf-jaguar hybrid beast that they encounter later in the novella drips with both blood and an unidentified greenish substance when stabbed with a pike, an indication of taint and corruption. The derelict starcraft left behind by the original colonists displays a comparable rust and greenish patina that had corroded the metal. Unlike New Beacon, the colors of Earth are integral to nature and objects, but often indicate corruption, decay, and deterioration. Franciosi emphasizes this degradation from artificial lights to inherent natural colors with the use of muted hues that she modifies with a derivational morpheme in part two of the novella. The muted colors of Earth are in stark contrast to the hyper-realistic colors of New Beacon, indicating a chromatic recession that runs along the middle of the novella's structure. Emil and his fellow pariahs are unfamiliar with this damaged planet, and the ersatz pigments aptly reflect the nature of the fallen world. On Earth, the author introduces colors with the diminutive suffix astro, a modification that she does not employ with those on New Beacon. The first of these astro colors describes Earth's sky when the survivors search for shelter after their crash landing. When a storm begins, the sky takes on a bluish, blue astra, tint, in which while thunder begins to mutter in the distance. The ambiguous hue of the firmament reflects the uncertainty that Emil and his fellow exiles feel as they crash land on this strange new world. They have never before experienced a storm, and their safety on this frightening and unfamiliar planet is by no means guaranteed. The color blue astro, like the reader encounters here, counts itself among many such nebulous colors with connotations that find them as ugly, grigiastro or vedastro, impure, verdastro, uncertain, grigiastro, dull, blueastro, ill-defined, blueastro again, and approximate, tainted or dirty, biancastro. The aforementioned green hue in the greenish patina on the ruins of the Mayflower II ship and the greenish ooze that drips from the wolf-jaguar beast indicates corrosion, corruption, and disease, all an embodiment of the impurity indicated by its very definition. Other examples of the astro colors of Earth include whitish and grayish. The former describes the smoke or mist that the rain from the storm causes as the survivors fall asleep, as well as the tubers that the indigenous Odawari tribe give them as sustenance. The sky often takes on a grayish hue either when the storm first hits and pelts the survivors with hail, or when the grayish light of day finally breaks. Trecani and other such dictionaries define the suffix astro itself as also of generic value depreciating or productive, which first serves to form names of plants, indicating the wild species with respect to the cultivated or gentle species. An interesting parallel exists here and reinforces the preceding argument of overlaid versus inherent colorations. New Beacon controls and carefully constructs its colors, which do not merge with its nature and which its inhabitants do not feel. The colors on Earth, although inferior and unpretentious, run wild and untamed as they partake in nature. Earth's flora and fauna boast a grayish hue, from the trees to the man-made metal cans that seem to have merged with nature itself as a new parasitic and infesting flora. The reddish-brown spots of radiation poisoning, although an indication of pain and decay, are felt and experienced. They are real. The colors of Earth are also made of color and depth, but everything is mixed in a confused swirl. Both the astro colors and the prevalence of gray, a muted color born of both of the chromatic opposites black and white, highlight the imperfect and messy aspect of the ecosystem newly freed from humankind's dominance. On Earth, color is imperfect, understated, natural, and inherent in the objects and beings that inhabit it. On New Beacon, colors are bright, controlled, and superimposed onto objects and beings. Alongside this distinction is the struggle between light and darkness throughout the novella, which is most prominent at the fault line that runs between the work's two parts. Light and darkness struggle persistently throughout the entirety of the novella, with Emil caught between. Light, whether polychromatic or not, attempts to repel the endemic predatory darkness on New Beacon. Here, light and darkness engage in an argument of luminescence in which light defies, chases, and mocks, while darkness swallows and consumes. The pulsating lights and colored festoons of Emil's computer screens darken when shut down, swallowing every color. The colored lights of the brightly lit corridor of his office building seem to make a mockery of the darkness beyond the windows. The park lights meant to accentuate New Beacon's fauna try to chase away the dark notes of twilight. The leaders of the triumvirate state in their celebration speech that their light illuminates the darkness of barbarism. The most spectacular appears to be the bewitching fireworks, at first losing themselves in the darkness with a whistle, but later explode in a spectacle of colors, and thus defy and mock the darkness that engulfed the New Beacon sun too early and for too long. After his act of rebellion, as if seeming to imitate the bold actions of light itself, Emil flees to the border and leaves behind the illuminated buildings of the capital and sinks into the darkness of the border that seems to swallow the glow of the headlights like a black hole. After his arrest, the cryogenic formula with which he is injected allows darkness to overtake him for his trip to Earth. This battle between light and dark entangles with the protagonist, with white light in particular causing him pain. The white light of large street lamps, fari di luce, at the roadside hurt his eyes. One can translate the framfaro in several ways. The most fitting in this context is a street lamp, but in other instances throughout the novel, lighthouse and beacon spring to mind. The fari harm Emil rather than guide and reassure him. The artificial lights illuminate but do not assist him in actually seeing. Symbolic of the negative utopia of New Beacon, they light up the streets but manage to make the darkness even darker. Earth's light periodically seems to threaten the same struggle but does not persist. Apart from his crash landing, Emil becomes accustomed to the uniform gray light on Earth that extinguishes and smooths out every shade of color. It does not cause him pain as it did on New Beacon, but rather the natural glare of the grayish daylight simply causes him to squint. The pitch black only reminds him of the dark skies of New Beacon, but does not consume the light. The struggle between light and dark even symbolically manifests in the differences of skin color. Emil realizes how white his skin is compared to that of the tribe, he says. Their skin, so delicate compared to that of the natives, is prey to insects and covered with boils. The Odawadi call the survivors children of the stars, fallen space travelers, with skin as white as the foam of the sea and untouched by the signs of devastation. The struggle between darkness and light dissipates on Earth toward the end of the novella. The survivors eventually develop their own red spots of radiation poisoning, and the clouds, neither dark nor light nor a grigiastro color, remain a simple gray. This reconciliation of color reflects in the peace that Emil finally achieves on Earth at the denouement. Earth harbors no artificial color as on New Beacon, but rather substantial, albeit ersatz pigmentation. It is not an easy life, but it is real. The sea breeze that Emil inhales is full of toxic fumes, but it tastes like freedom to him. Only in those last few years among the Odawari had he been able to understand what it really means to live. The struggle between light and dark and the struggle for freedom culminates in the novella's chromatic rift. In the transitional points at the end of part one and the very beginning of part two, the author meditates on the concept of privation through color, primarily black and white, but also red and yellow, or blonde. Emil crashes his car in his attempt to flee the consequences of his rebellious actions, after which he regains consciousness in an empty white room. The color white as an absence of color, or a reflection of all color, the emptiness, the cold temperature, and Emil's bare feet all reinforce the concept of nothingness and reflect the protagonist's mental state of hopelessness. The blinding, solitary light hanging from the ceiling causes Emil pain, reminding the reader of the lights from previous chapters. The white room, with its overwhelming light, starkly contrasts with the dark figure of Emil's interrogator, whom the reader is led to believe is one of New Beacon's triumvirate leaders. The white enhances the dark outline of the interrogator dressed in black, whose face remains consistently an inky shadow. The light surrounds him as if he were a divine being. Compounding this godlike image is the fleeting and perhaps mistaken impression of glimpsing a blonde glimmer on the interrogator's head as the man in black crosses the threshold. The interrogator beats Emil, and the periodic bursts of color from his blood create an almost symbolic resistance to the ominous privation of this scene. Emil's blood emphasizes his humanity, his reality, waking him from his reverie of both the bewitching hyper-realistic kaleidoscope of colors and blinding lights of New Beacon leading up to this moment. The colors of New Beacon are manufactured, intense, and illusory, just like the fleeting glimpse of the interrogator's blonde hair, attempting to convince its citizens of its false utopia through bright advertisement and distraction. It reminds one of highly processed sugary foods made with both artificial and natural flavors that undoubtedly taste more of the former than the latter. Through spiteful artificial color pitted against natural darkness, the author juxtaposes illusion and reality, with Emil's blood foreshadowing the experience of painful, authentic life, albeit brutal and short, on Earth. The removal of Emil's nanobots before his exile finalizes this cleansing from artificial to real. When Emil lands on Earth in the following chapter, he is met with a monstrous sea creature that resonates with the interrogator from the previous chapter. Like the interrogator, the author describes the sea monster as dark and sublime, a pure atavistic and primordial terror, whose shiny tail rises out of the water like a divine hand. On Earth, nature and animals, not humankind, dominate the planet, once again the rulers of their world. Through the use of color as a barometer for reality, this novella constitutes a type of social science fiction in which the author uses two distinct settings to engage in a discussion about humankind's place in the environment. On New Beacon, a negative utopia for the elite where everything is synthetic and deceptive, humankind is forbidden to commit the same environmental mistakes as their ancestors did, but neither can they truly partake in its world. Emil finds that although destroyed by man's hand, Earth is more real because humans are a part of it. No longer spectators, istanti, as they were at the Hilton pub, humans are now participants free from the nanobots that infiltrate their bodies and distract them from life. They coexist with nature and each other, but only through pain and hardship, exercising their freedom to breathe the toxic air they created.
Yeah. Did you encounter any descriptions of colors or names of colors that you thought you might have fun translating in any particular ways if you were translating them?
You know, interestingly enough, I think this novella was really basic in that way, though. You know, she used very basic colors with the exception of the canary yellow and other such things, but I did have fun with that one.
Aside from the astro colors that you talked about, were there any associations with certain colors, like how, you know, just if you say the color blue, people have an association, or just even the idea of warm colors and cold colors. Mm-hmm. Does any of that have any meaning in this world?
It's interesting because, as I had mentioned with the previous question, there is kind of a spectrum, although it's very simplified. There are some terms that are used for New Beacon that are very specific, like the canary yellow or scarlet red or something like that. And then there's the more basic ones, blue, red, yellow, orange, with no any kind of modifier whatsoever. And then the astro colors of Earth, and that is pretty much as far as it goes, interestingly.
Was there any sign of, like, I don't know, red is symbolic of passion or, you know, something like that?
No, nothing like that that I've come across. Although I suppose you can keep in the consideration of the looking at certain scenes, like for the blood, for example. But that's my own interpretation, not hers, of course.
One book that came to my mind is this book. It's called Prismatic Ecologies.
Oh, okay.
I don't know if you're familiar with that. It's Jeffrey Cohen and Lowell Duckert. It's a book that basically disassociates the color green from the usual, you know, association that we have with green with ecological thinking. Mm-hmm. So there are other colors that can be
equally ecological in a way. So there are interesting contributions in combining like a creative and critical stance that kind of make this point. And so I was wondering if, besides in the astro, I came back, but mm-hmm. there is this kind of ecological or association with specific colors there in the novel. Plus, the other question I had is it a? I was looking at the page, so you kept referring at this thing as a novella, but mm-hmm. is it a long novella? Is it like a novel?
It's a racconto lungo.
Racconto lungo, because it looked like it was very hundreds of pages.
No, on this one, no.
It's not. Okay, no, so that's not, I misread the reading, the number of pages.
No, yeah, no, no. That's so the page numbers that I actually use, I was using it on Kindle, so the location was actually the location number of a digital book. I'm sorry. No, no. Forgive me for any confusion that might have caused. Yeah, it's another reason why I tried to include LOC to make sure it was locazione instead of pagina.
Just a curiosity about the publisher, Futuro Presente, if you could tell us a little bit about this publisher and the kind of publications that they...
Absolutely. So Delos Digital puts out a number of collane, and Futuro Presente is one of them. They put out a number of other ones, like Sherlock is another, and there's a few dedicated to mysteries and so forth. But primarily any kind of science fiction that's longer than a short story, but shorter than a novel, are published through them. And it ranges very widely, so all sorts of science fiction is represented there by a number of different authors. It's quite good.